So I will start by just saying that we are doing a really great job of introducing plants and animals from one part of the world to other parts of the world where they've never been. So this is a slide that I stole off the interwebs showing that Walmart is just packaging up materials and sending them all over the place. So plants and animals get introduced into regions they've never been before, both deliberately and accidentally. So some of the deliberate introductions are made because plants and animals have some sort of use for us, right? With respect to plants, we've often imported plants that are aggressive growers, right? We need them to provide forage for livestock or to grow really aggressively and stabilize hillsides, things like that. These are actually traits that make them really good invasive species. Same thing with animals. We often introduce animals, sometimes through the exotic pet trade, and these animals escape, but they were originally deliberately introduced into areas. Accidental introductions happen all of the time. So both plants and animals can get involved or get into shipping containers and packing materials and things like that and get accidentally introduced. And so now we are kind of left with this legacy of all these previous introductions into these systems. So I'm going to be throwing out a lot of terms today, so I just want to make sure we're all on the same page. So I tend to use the term non-native for species. That just means that it wasn't in an area before humans put it in that area. Okay, so humans are essential in creating this dynamic of non-native species. Some people will use the terms exotic or alien. I tend to avoid those, and I just use non-native. But these terms are actually very different than invasive. So invasive has a different meaning. So you can have a non-native plant. So like a banana plant in my yard in Southern California, it's not native to Southern California, but it's not going to be invasive there. It requires way too much water. It's not going to spread on its own. So that term invasive is actually used for species that can spread outside of the area of introduction. And I'm a plant ecologist, so I'm going to focus a lot on plants. And so where I can, I'll start putting some animal examples in for those of you who are interested in animals. So this is a picture of the Burmese python, which has become invasive in the Florida Everglades. Probably some of you know way more about this example than I do. But my guess is that this was introduced by people who had these giant python as pets and started freaking out and then decided that they were going to just put them into the wild. And then they created this big population, and they've been decimating all kinds of native wildlife in the Everglades. So there's been a big push to capture these monsters and get them out of the Everglades because they're doing a lot of damage there. And this is a table that I like to use to just kind of illustrate what I mean when I'm talking about invasive versus just non-native. So this is based on a paper. It's very old now. But if a species was initially transported into a region by humans, then we consider that not native. If it can spread into habitats not previously occupied once it's in that, that new habitat, then we do consider it invasive. And it's really species in this quadrant here, the invasive non-native plants and animals. These are the ones that invasion biologists are actually studying. These are the ones that often have impacts that we don't care for in systems. So there is a philosophical discussion going on both in academia and even in the popular press about whether or not we should care if a species is not native. Here are some titles from some of the academic papers that have been published recently on this topic. And so I think the idea is, like, why are we villainizing a species just because a human brought it to a system? And I think that there are there's some merit in this argument. I'm curious to know where you all fall out in this debate. In particular, is this idea of novel ecosystems, I think, has some merit. And this is based on this idea that there are some invasive species that are just so prevalent, we're never going to be able to get rid of them. I had a really great lunch with some students who were talking about carp in some of the lakes around here and how we're probably never going to be able to get rid of carp. But we can figure out ways to manage these systems so that we can promote native species in addition to having some of these invasives as well. So we're not going to ever return to historical conditions, but instead we now have these novel ecosystems that we need to manage. So, but in general, I fall out on the, guilty until proven innocent, because oftentimes these invasive species get into systems and we don't really know the full extent of their impacts. So maybe that is one reason that we should be studying them. So I want to just kind of briefly go over some of the deleterious impacts that invasive species can have. And I forgot to mention that some of the estimates are maybe 1 to 2% of all invasive species do have deleterious impacts. So it's not the vast majority of species. Most of the species that are out there are not having any sort of discernible impact that we know of. So the first reason we should care about invasive species are that they can affect human health, right? They affect our own species. We should care about that. One example I like to use, the mosquito, which is not native to North America, as far as I know, can spread West Nile virus. So they can actually pick up the virus from biting infected birds and then transmit it to humans and other livestock that we care about. So some invasive species can serve as vectors for disease that directly impact humans. Invasive species can also have really big economic impacts, and one of the best case studies for this is the zebra mussel that was introduced from Europe into North America. This was introduced accidentally by ships that picked up a bunch of ballast water in Europe and then traveled across the Atlantic and then dumped out that ballast water. And these zebra mussels very quickly spread into a lot of the freshwater systems in North America. I've even seen some signs in lakes, like freshwater systems in the West, kind of pointing out this to boaters and to try to look out for zebra mussels. I don't know, are they here? Are they in Utah?
Yeah.
They are here.
Yeah.
That's scary. All right. So here's a picture of a beach that's completely littered with their shells after the animals die. So they often make beaches unusable. Here's a bunch of zebra mussels that are using this larger native mussel as a substrate. So they're basically having adverse effects on some of the native fauna. And this picture just is here to remind me, to tell you that they just colonize everything, right? So they will clog sewer drain pipes, they will clog all kinds of things. And so we spend millions of dollars a year dealing with removing these zebra mussels from different structures. Invasive plants can also have really big economic impact. So this is kudzu, which was introduced to the Southeast from Asia. So this is a really, really fast growing vine. And so pretty much everything that you can see in the foreground, maybe not back there, but everything in the foreground is basically kudzu. So it is grown over all of these trees. It will grow, I can't remember, there was some statistic that I read where it can actually cover a car or cover a house or something like within an order of a week or something like that. So millions of dollars again spent annually removing kudzu from structures. Invasive species can decrease biodiversity. So I mentioned some of these examples already. But one of my favorite examples to talk about is the brown tree snake, which was introduced accidentally to the island of Guam. So it hitched a ride to Guam on a military plane. And when it got there, it had no predators. And so it just went to town on feasting on all the bird species there. I haven't been to Guam, and maybe somebody who's been to Guam can confirm this, but I've heard that it's just kind of eerie and that there's just no birds present at all, that there's no birds. Is that true? Has anyone been to Guam? Anyway, so it's been really, really hard to eradicate, and in fact, they keep finding brown tree snakes on planes coming from Guam to other oceanic islands like Hawaii, so it's quite possible that this animal can spread to other nearby islands, which is really scary. Plants can also have big impacts on native biodiversity. This is a picture from one of my field sites on the Leeward Island of Hawaii, the Big Islands. This individual pictured here, which is not in really great shape at the time, this was from 2005. This is a really rare endemic plant. It's in the Fabaceae. It's a nitrogen fixer. Endemic means that it occurs nowhere else in the world. The Hawaiian common name is uhi uhi. At the time of this photo, there were 7 individuals in the wild. It's now extinct in the wild, although we do still have seeds, and it does occur in botanical gardens. But basically, it was unable to recruit because of all of this massive fountain grass, which is a C4 grass that was introduced from South Africa to the Big Island of Hawaii and actually has spread to some of the other islands from there. So this grass, basically, you can see how dense it is. It sucks up all the water, and it shades out any native seedlings that are trying to recruit in the understory. And so a lot of these dry forest species have basically gone extinct in the wild because of this one fountain grass species on the islands. And then lastly, invasive species can alter ecosystem functions. So I very broadly define ecosystem function as a physical, chemical, or biological process that contributes to the self-maintenance of an ecosystem. So I like to think about this as what the ecosystem does. And we get a lot of services from ecosystems. So for example, they provide wildlife habitat. They often sequester carbon, which has been really helpful for us. If you're thinking about wetlands, they can also trap nutrients, which is really helpful. And so an invasive species that comes in and alters these ecosystem functions is serious. We should care about that because we get a lot of services from these ecosystems. One of the examples that I like to talk about in this category is how an invasive species have come into Southern California and changed the fire frequency. So this is a picture of in Crystal Cove State Park in Orange County. This is a place that I like to go hiking a lot. And I love this photo because it has on one part of the hillside, this is all very pristine, native-dominated coastal sage scrub. And in the foreground, this part of the hillside has been invaded by black mustard, which is an annual forb that was introduced to Southern California from the Mediterranean. And this picture was taken in October. So this is after our long, hot, dry summer, and it's kind of right when the Santa Ana winds are ripping through canyons and spreading fire, and it's really hot and dry. And so this annual species, it germinates in November, and it completes its life cycle by May or June. So it leaves all of this very, very dry, flammable biomass just sitting there going into our hot, dry fire season. So when this stuff ignites, it ignites very quickly and spreads fire through these canyons. The native vegetation, as you can see here, is still green, right? We have a lot of evergreen species that retain leaves. Throughout the year, those leaves have water in them. So even though our native systems in California are fire adapted, they're used to fire, it's a natural part of the system, they don't ignite as quickly, and they don't spread fire as quickly. So the fires are actually easier to contain than they are in hillsides that are dominated by these invasive forbs and grasses. So this is an example where invasive species have come in and really changed the fire frequency in Southern California. Another example from the southwestern United States is tamarisk, or salt cedar. Some of you might be familiar with this. I'm pretty sure it's in Utah. It's in Utah, okay. All right, so you know this. So this has kind of taken over these riparian areas and deserts and displaced a lot of the native riparian vegetation like cottonwoods and other things like that. So people have been concerned because it grows in such high density and it has really, really high transpiration rates. And so it's changed the hydrology of these regions quite a bit. But this species is really controversial because even though it has this deleterious impact, it's actually providing a lot more habitat for migratory bird species than a lot of the native vegetation did. So you have a lot of people who get really upset when you talk about removing tamarisk, and so it's actually become one of these really controversial species in invasion biology. All right, so what can we do about invaders? I'm going to be talking about four things in this part of the talk. The first is prevention, right? So we could save ourselves all a lot of hassle if we just prevent the movement, either accidental or deliberate, of plants and animals from one part of the world to another. You've probably all heard the saying, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. It's much, much cheaper to deal with preventing invasive species from getting into places in the first place. So a lot of places just don't have restrictions on the importation of plants and animals. Like, I was really shocked to learn when I moved to Hawaii that places like botanical gardens, like the Hawaii Tropical Botanical Garden in Hilo, I'm totally going to single them out, they have been responsible for introducing the majority of the really nasty species in Hawaii. In particular, they are responsible for importing Australian tree fern and Clydemia, which have been complete monsters for the state to deal with. So there are just very, very loose regulations on what kinds of plants and animals can be brought into the states. My understanding is that this sort of conflicts with some of these free trade policies. Even at the Walmart in Hilo, they're bringing in plants from Puerto Rico and other things. And who knows what's in the soil? I mean, these things aren't sterilized. I mean, it's really, really strange that even in this day and age, we still don't have policies in place to prevent these sorts of things. With accidental introductions, we can do a lot more as well. I like to use New Zealand as a really great example. If any of you have ever traveled to New Zealand, they have this questionnaire for you to fill out when you get there, and they ask you if you have any hiking or camping equipment with you, and if you say yes to any of these things, and they detour you into this very long line, and they make you like take your hiking boots out, and they look for, they're basically looking for soil, they're looking for seeds, and I think this is a really great program. I feel like we should do more of these things to prevent the accidental introduction of plants and animals from one part of the world to another. And oftentimes, it's hard. I think that we still have to have this guilty until proven innocent approach, because even if we think a species might not be invasive and we're like, sure, we can import that, it doesn't appear to be invasive, it might become invasive. So here's some data. This is actually, I don't have this information on the slide, but this is prickly pear dynamics. So this is like the number of individuals of prickly pear in South Africa. So prickly pear is native to North America, but very invasive in the Mediterranean and in South Africa. So it was introduced in the late 1800s, and there were probably just a few individuals, and it stayed like that for 50 years. And then all of a sudden, like in 1940, you get this rapid expansion, and then eventually it leveled off. And I'm not quite sure why it leveled off, because it's particularly invasive in the Mediterranean. There's a lot of reasons this could happen, right? There might have been too few individuals for them to reproduce. Maybe they were missing like a critical pollinator or seed disperser or something like that. And so a species that might appear to not be very invasive could become very invasive, which is why I feel like we should, have this blanket policy where we just don't import plants and animals until we've done a lot of testing of those species. All right, second, we can develop early detection methods, because we know even with those policies that some of these species are going to slip through the cracks. One of the methods that I really think is incredibly cool is the use of remote sensing to detect invasive species. I don't know if this works for animals, but this is definitely something you can do for plants. So this is a picture from one of Greg Asner's works. So he was working in Hawaii Volcanoes National Park. This is the Kilauea Crater. This is Kilauea Iki Crater, for those of you who are familiar with the park. So what he does is he flies over these areas with an airplane, and he has this fancy spectrophotometer that he uses to collect canopy water and nitrogen data. And so in Hawaii Volcanoes National Park, you have these two particularly nasty invaders. You have a canopy invader, which is Morella thia. It's a nitrogen fixer. It has really high nitrogen in its leaves relative to the native vegetation. So it's really easy to see, to distinguish that from the native plants. And then there's also an understory invader called Kahili ginger. It's actually very beautiful, and the flower, I understand why it was imported. It's gorgeous, and the flower smells really nice. It's about 3 feet tall or so, and it has a really high canopy water content, okay? So if he flies over here, he can spot these areas that are in dark blue. That's basically just totally dominated by Kahili ginger. There's these spots that are bright green. You know that that's just a stand of faya. And you have high water and nitrogen. All of these red areas is basically an understory of ginger and an overstory canopy of faya. And then all this blue is basically native forest. So these maps are really useful, because this is a huge area, and you can imagine trying to send invasive species removal crews and trying to figure out how to prioritize areas to send these crews so that they can be more efficient at eradicating species. And especially, might help you eradicate small populations that you might be able to eradicate before they become much larger. So I know that this technique would only be very useful if you have invasive species that differ dramatically from the native plant community. But I know that his group they're busy quantifying other things like pigments and other secondary compounds. And I think their goal is to identify these biochemical fingerprints of individual species. So you can fly over rainforest and fly over these big forests and be able to find not only invasive species, but endangered species, and be able to see all these species from space, which I think is just one of the coolest techniques ever. All right. Ecological restoration is another thing that you can do about invasive species, and this is kind of my wheelhouse, and I'll be talking a lot more about this in my research seminar tomorrow. But this is essentially what we need to do once invasive species are in the system and we need to figure out how to manage them. So ecological restoration very generally is the process of assisting the recovery of an ecosystem that has been degraded, damaged, or destroyed. And increasingly, restoration projects are having to deal with invasive species just because they become so prevalent. And there's a large range of restoration projects. Some of them can be really simple. So the two examples I like to talk about are just, you know, examples where you go in and you make one modification to the system and then you walk away. There's no follow-up or continued management. Like you might go in and remove a dam to restore natural flooding conditions and then that's it. Or you might determine that invasive species seeds are being introduced by ungulates and so you put up fences to remove ungulates. So those can be considered examples of simple restoration projects. But on the other end, you can have like more complicated restoration projects. These might be where you're trying to restore soil that's been polluted. You might try to go in with bulldozers to remove a bunch of invasive species and the seeds that are in the topsoil. And then you might plant a bunch of natives and run irrigation lines and then send crews back for the next 10 years to manually pull weeds. And these projects can be very labor intensive and very expensive. So there's a bunch of different types of restoration projects. So here's a picture of some of my students in a class where we actually did a restoration of a little tract in the Irvine Ranch Conservancy. So this right here, this is all black mustard during the growing season. So it's really, really healthy and very dense, and you can see it's almost as tall as my students. So we ripped all of this out, and we actually planted native species and then came back several years later to see which species prevented the reintroduction of this black mustard, because some of the native species are going to be better competitors than others. So these types of experiments, some of the information and, that we can get out of them, are really helpful in trying to make restoration, the process of restoration, more cost-effective and more efficient. And again, I'll be talking a little bit more about these approaches in my research talk tomorrow. And the last thing that we can do about invaders is biological control. So this is the idea that you've introduced a native plant or animal from its home range into an introduced range. And by doing that, it's escaped its natural enemies. Okay? So this whole idea of biological control is that you go back to the invasive species home range, you find its native enemy, and then you reintroduce or you introduce that to control the invasive species in its new range. Right. I am not a big fan of biological control just because there's been some spectacular failures. And so I will tell you about my two favorite spectacular failures here. So the cane toad was introduced to Australia, I think, in the 1920s or 30s. So they were trying to grow sugar cane, and they actually had a native insect, the cane beetle, that was decimating the sugar cane. So the cane toad is native to Brazil, but they actually introduced some individuals from Hawaii over to Australia. And when the cane beetle or the cane toad got there, it never ate the cane beetle. The cane beetle was kind of up high up in the sugar cane, and the cane toad was basically eating insects on the ground. So it never actually fixed the problem that it was designed to solve. And it actually created more problems. There's toxins in the skin of the toad. And so all the dingoes and kangaroos or, you know, whatever the native wildlife were that tried to eat this thing got sick or died. And it also started voraciously eating a lot of the native insects. So it created a lot more problems than it solved. The mongoose was introduced into Hawaii to control rats. So rats were actually introduced to the island pretty early on by the European settlers, and they became a problem because they started eating bird and turtle eggs. So they wanted to introduce the mongoose to eat the rats. So the mongoose, it turns out, is diurnal, and the rats are nocturnal. So they never came into contact, and the mongoose never ate the rats. Instead, the mongoose is like, wow, look at all these tasty bird and turtle eggs. So they just exacerbated the problem. So there have been actually some good examples of biocontrol working. So in Hawaii, I know that they introduced an insect to control strawberry guava, which is a particularly aggressive, I'd like to call it a super invader. It really has no weaknesses at all. But they have seen some control of the population through the introduction of this insect. But what makes me really nervous about biocontrol is that we know that organisms can evolve and adapt, right? So we have no guarantee that if you introduce one of these natural enemies, that it won't just, even after 5 or 10 years of examining how its behavior works in the new environment, that it won't switch to start attacking a native plant or animal that you care about. So I think it's a pretty dangerous approach and should be only used as a last resort. But if any of you have different opinions, I'd love to hear about it at the end of the talk. All right, so now I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about some exciting research directions in the field of invasion ecology. And so just to be totally clear, this represents my biases. These are the directions that I think are really interesting and exciting. But I think we're very well poised to make significant advances in these areas over the next 5 to 10 years. So there's still a lot we don't know about invasive species, all the way from the gene up to the ecosystem, right? We have really no idea how a lot of these invasive species are going to evolve to changes in the environment. Right now, there's been a lot of work on functional traits. I've been working on that area for the last 10 years or so. And we're trying to figure out if you can actually use traits to predict invasion dynamics, to predict restoration outcomes. There's a lot of work going into species interactions, so what kind of interactions are non-native plants and animals having with other non-native plants and animals or native species in the system. And then at the very end, I'll talk a little bit about impacts of invasive species, and even if we think we know what the impacts of invasive species are, these might change over time, and I'll present an example of that happening. All right, so how are invasive species going to adapt to climate change? This is a really active area of research in the field, and I'll present some data that I've collected in my lab. This is actually a student-run project, so 3 undergraduates at Chapman conducted this experiment and published it in the Journal of Ecology, which I couldn't be more excited about. So we took advantage of a nearby experiment that some folks at UC Irvine had been doing. So they had been growing grasslands under 3 different water treatments. So we had an ambient treatment, and in Southern California, that's about 13 inches of rain a year. And then we had a 40% reduction of water and then a 40% addition of water. So they exposed all of these grassland species to these 3 water conditions for 5 years. And then we came in and we collected seeds of this one Mediterranean grass. It's really, really abundant in Southern California. It's Avena barbata, or wild oat. And we took those seeds back to California, or to Chapman, and we grew them in pots for 2 years to get rid of any maternal effects. And then we looked for differences in phenotypic traits to see if exposure to these different water treatments over 5 years was enough to have any sort of genetically linked changes. And we found out, surprisingly, that it was. So after just 5 years of growing in these different conditions, we found differences in things like flowering time. So we found some differences in other traits as well. I'm just kind of showing you just one example of this here. But the ambient and the reduced water treatment actually flowered earlier in the year compared to the water addition treatment. And this makes sense if you're a plant. If you're exposed to very low amounts of water, you don't know what the future holds. You don't know if there's going to be another storm coming to give you more water. You only have that one growing season to grow and make seed. So you want to speed up your phenology. You want to make sure that you can actually produce seed before you die, basically, from drought. And we actually found that strategy was really effective. So individuals from those 2 treatments actually had higher seed biomass than the individuals from the water addition treatment. So this was really frightening to us. I think it has really important management implications. So after just 5 years, this one grass species was able to adapt to reduced water. So I think a lot of us were really excited thinking like, okay, well, in Southern California, it's supposed to get about 20% drier over the next 50 to 100 years. The native plants are well adapted to this sort of variation. They'll be fine and all of the invasive species will suffer. But these data suggest that the invasive species might be just fine, at least the annuals who are able to adapt on these really short timescales. So this was actually one of the first studies that has shown that invasive species can adapt on this short of a timescale. But there is some good news. some good news is that native species might also be able to adapt as well. And here's some data I'm presenting from Beth Ledger's lab. I found that Beth Ledger is actually coming. She's a seminar speaker in this series, so that's great. I'm sure she'll talk about this work and some of her other work too. So what she did was she actually found that some of these native plants can adapt to be better competitors with invasive species. So she went out to two different regions. So one area was a pristine, kind of native-dominated area, and one was kind of this invaded, disturbed area where you had both native and invasive species co-occurring together. And she took seeds of a native bunch grass. So this is Elmus elmoides, the common name is squirrel tail. And so she brought these seeds back to the lab, and she grew them in the presence of Bromus tectorum, which is cheatgrass. It's a particularly aggressive invasive grass species. And she looked at the biomass of the cheatgrass when it was growing by itself, so it basically was just competing with other members of its own species. She looked at how it grew when it was grown with seeds from individuals that were collected from that invaded area. Okay, so the mother plants essentially here were used to growing with other invasive species. And then she compared it with individuals of squirrel tail that were from that pristine native dominated area. So presumably these mother plants had never seen another invasive species, right? And she found this really striking pattern, right? So the species that, or the individuals that she collected from that invaded area were actually better at suppressing the growth of the invasive cheatgrass. So they had evolved to become better competitors with the invasive species. So again, I think this has really, really cool management implications. So if you're a restoration practitioner and you have option to select seed of native plants from anywhere, I would definitely go to these really degraded, rundown areas where the native plants are used to growing in competition with invasive species, because they might have evolved to be better competitors. So when you create your native-dominated restored environments, those plants that you're putting in there should be more competitive if those non-native plants try to reinvade that habitat. So I think that there's some really like, this is one study that's been done. We clearly need to follow up on this, but I think that it's promising that native plants can adapt as well. All right, the second question that I think, again, we're really poised to make good advances on in the next 5 to 10 years is, can plant traits suggest management strategies? So again, this is the area that I work in, and I'll be talking a lot more about this tomorrow. But the idea is that often you can have invasive and native plant species in a community. So each one of these dots here is a different species in your community. Sometimes they can be functionally distinct. Okay, so I have them grouped here based on carbon assimilation traits. So this is like species on this end of the graph would have high photosynthetic rates and high growth rates. And then phenology traits. So this might be the timing of germination or the timing of flowering. So in this particular community here, these are all made up data, by the way, the invasive species are really different. They've come in and they've exploited some unoccupied niche in the community. Over here, you have functionally similar native and invasive species. Okay, so there's a lot more overlap, and the species really aren't all that different from each other. So it's quite possible that these differences or similarities can suggest different management strategies. So for example, if your species are functionally distinct, you might be able to apply herbicide or mow or graze when the invasive species are active. So in a lot of systems, people have found that invasive species will always germinate earlier in the growing season. So that gives managers like a 2 to 4 week window to come in and just spray herbicides and try to get rid of them before the native species pop up. At the community level, you might try to reinstate original disturbance regimes. Or reduced resource availability. So oftentimes, invasive species can come in and exploit a new niche because we've opened a new niche for them, right? So we've provided a bunch of fertilizer into a lake or into a terrestrial system, or we've introduced grazing animals into a system, or we've changed it in some way that's made it habitable for the invasive species. So oftentimes, going in and trying to get rid of some of those processes can help get rid of the invasive species. When the invasive and native species are functionally similar, that might suggest different things like a specific herbicide. So perhaps your invasive and native species are very similar with respect to resource use, but all of your invasive species are grasses. So maybe you can go in and use a grass-specific herbicide to get rid of them. As a last resort, maybe you do biocontrol, or maybe you have to do manual weeding in that system. At a community level, maybe you start planting or seeding native species that you know are going to be super competitors, like the ones that I just showed you on the previous slide. So there are very few empirical tests of this framework, and I've been working on it for the last 10 years or so, but I do think that we'll have some more answers to this in the next 5 to 10 years, and maybe this framework doesn't work at all, and that's totally fine, but it's one of the dominant frameworks right now in the field. All right, the next thing I want to talk about is species interactions, and I want to single out plant-soil feedbacks, which I think are incredibly cool. We have no idea what's going on below ground. Below ground processes are really hard to study. I'm going to illustrate an example from Sarah Cubbing's work, which she published a couple of years ago. She was working in these southeastern forests. These are deciduous forests, and these are three non-native woody shrub species. And what she did was she grew all three of these in soil that had either been sterilized, or soil that had been conditioned by another non-native species. Okay, so I actually don't know why she didn't grow them in soil that had been conditioned by this non-native. But she grew all three of them in soil that had been conditioned by these other species. And conditioned just means that she had grown those species in the soil and then pulled them out and then used that soil to plant these species. And so what this axis is, this is the feedback axis. If it's negative, that means that the species grew better in the soil that was conditioned by the other non-native species compared to the sterilized soil. If it was positive, that means the species grew better in the sterilized soil relative to the conditioned soil. And these bars are really just basically biomass, so growth of the non-native plants. So two of the three species grew better in soil that had been conditioned by other non-natives. And she wasn't able to tease apart the mechanism here, so she doesn't know if maybe those other non-native species were harboring beneficial soil microbes like mycorrhizal fungi that often help plants take up phosphorus and water, or it could be that they came in and they changed the soil chemistry in a way that actually promoted the growth of the non-native species. She wasn't sure about that. But I think that results like this are really important. They support this phenomenon that invasion biologists have identified called invasional meltdown. And this is the idea that you can have one invasive species that moves in, and it changes the system in a way that makes it more attractive or facilitates the invasion of other non-native species. And then all of a sudden, you just have a system that's dominated by a bunch of non-native species. So again, I think that we're poised to make some really, really cool discoveries below ground to see what plants are doing and what kind of feedbacks they have with the soil chemistry and soil microbes. And then the last thing I want to talk about are impacts of invasive species. So kind of going back to that philosophical discussion I was referring to earlier about whether or not we should demonize invasive species, I think a lot of that comes back to this idea of like, well, what impacts are they having? And I think we don't actually know what impacts a lot of these invasive species are having, or we think that we know what their impacts are, and then we find out 20 years later that they actually have a different impact. So one of the greatest examples of this is some work that came out of Carla D'Antonio's lab. So she's been working in Hawaii for years and years, and one of her students working in the 90s found that there was this positive feedback cycle between this invasive grass, Melinus, and the soil nitrogen pool. So Melinus moved in and into the system, and it had a positive feedback on the soil, and it also required a lot of soil nitrogen. So what it does is it grows really quickly, but then when it dies, it also decomposes very quickly relative to the native species, and the nutrients that are in the foliage get returned to the soil faster. So in effect, it's coming in and speeding up the soil nutrient cycle, which only benefits it because it requires more nitrogen than a lot of the native plant species. So when they were there, they basically kind of said, all right, we've figured out what effect the species is having on the system. It's basically creating this positive soil nitrogen feedback. And we've figured this out, and we're going to go away. But they didn't go away because they're really good scientists. And they wanted to come back and see what the system was doing about 20 years later. And what they found 20 years later was that the system had actually shifted and was now being dominated by this other invasive species, Morellophaia, which is the nitrogen-fixing species I was talking about in that remote sensing slide earlier in the talk. And so what happens is that the grasses actually burn pretty easily, and when they burn, a lot of nitrogen is released from the system, which created decreases in the soil nitrogen pool. A nitrogen-fixing species like Morella can capitalize on that. It doesn't need to rely on soil nitrogen availability because it has microbes in nodules in the roots that it can get nitrogen from. And so this often facilitated the invasion in pockets of the area of this nitrogen-fixing tree. Because it's nitrogen-fixing, when its tissues die, all of that nitrogen is then returned to the system, which then increases the soil nitrogen pool, which then can increase the population of this grass. So now you have coexistence of these two invasive species in the system, mediated again by changes in the soil nitrogen pool. Okay, so this is a system like impacts that they thought they had figured out 20 years ago, but then they come back into the system to find out that cycle had broken down and it actually had facilitated the invasion of another fixer. Of another invasive species. So this is an argument that we need to understand the impacts of invasive species better, but we also need to understand how those impacts are going to shift over time. And so a lot of our funding cycles as scientists last 3 to 5 years, which really doesn't allow us to do these long-term studies. So I think that some of these long-term studies are going to be really important moving forward to understand these impacts. And I always like to end these sort of general invasion ecology talks by talking about what you can do. I don't really know what the dominant invasive species are in Utah. I could have researched that before I came. But these are some of the dominant ones in Southern California. And I usually encourage people, if they're going out and hiking, just to be aware of some of the wildland weeds. Oftentimes, like, there will be just really small populations of particularly nasty species, like artichoke thistles, one of the ones we have in Southern California. And if you go tell a ranger about that, like, they can often take care of that, those couple of individuals before they spread. So, like, some people spotting these things can make a difference. Lots of people in Southern California like to plant particularly nasty invasive species in their yards because they're very beautiful or seemingly beautiful. Like, I can't look at fountain grass and think it's beautiful, but some people do. Just be aware of plants that you're putting in your yard as well. There's a lot of really nice native options, I'm sure, here in Utah that you can put in your yards. So with that, I will end and take any questions you have.
We do have time for a few questions, but I want to remind everybody about the social following this talk, and I'm going to write the address on the board over here.
Yeah.
Is there, this from the beginning of your talk, is there like a state or a country that has a good model that you'd like to see other states or countries kind of their import and export for plants model that on?
Yeah, the only one I'm really familiar with is New Zealand. Yeah, so New Zealand has done a really great job with restricting the importation of things into the country and then also just screening people when they come in. I'm not really sure, like, if individual states in the U.S. have any policies like that. I'm not really sure about that, but I would hold up New Zealand as a model for that, for sure. Yeah.
So on the slide you had talking about with the cheatgrass and being able to like outperform or like they become more fit, mm-hmm. does that mean that they are like a better option to select because they have in their environment been able to compete better with or the natives against like cheatgrass or different options, or they're just better than ones that have that to compete? Like, have they been able to like totally outcompete it and so like cheatgrass is totally gone versus
Yeah. I think the idea is that we can get all the help we can, you know, if we can get all the help we can get, that'd be great. And so there might still need to be management of cheatgrass or, you know, whatever you have in the system. But if you are selecting strains or, you know, genotypes that are just like better competitors, then that can only help the situation. So, yeah, I'm not sure if she's actually gone and like done some of these restoration techniques. Like, when she comes later on, you should totally ask her about that. Yeah.
Someone who's worked with tamarisk, like, remove area? I'm not sure if you do any studies or anything that look at what changes had on ecosystem.
I don't know that. Yeah, so this is a biocontrol agent that they've introduced. Yeah, I don't even know. I didn't even know about that. So it sounds like you're pro biocontrol.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Maybe I can hold that up as a model, like if it's worked. I'll have to look into that and see how successful it's been. So yeah, I don't know, but I don't know the answer to that. Other things? Yeah, in the back.
Do plants tend to have more of a disruptive effect as invasive on animals?
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm not sure of that. Yeah. Does anyone else have any ideas on that? I don't study animals, and so I don't really know what the relative comparison would be there. But the examples that I know of, I think a lot of people really forward the animal examples, right? Because the animals can be really good predators and wipe out populations of some of the...
You can't change the whole disturbance regime.
The whole system, is that what you said?
Yeah, like the disturbance regime.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, there might be. I mean, there certainly are, you know, native ecosystem engineers like beavers and things like that. So I imagine if you have some sort of invasive organism, or it's like animal, that could do something like that, then that could definitely change things. But I just don't know of any examples, not being an animal person. Yeah?
So you implied that there might be some invasive species that don't have big impacts on the ecosystem, which kind of goes against, you know, our normal thinking. Can you come up with examples? It seems like by virtue of the fact that they're invasive, they're probably have impacts, but
yeah.
Can you think of invasive?
Well, like, so for example, in the systems that I work in, like in coastal sage scrub and the grasslands in Southern California, I mean, we have these, black mustard and the grasses that basically have changed fire frequency, but we also have these very low statured invaders like erodium and trifolium, and you know they don't produce enough biomass really to contribute to fire. They're really they can be very abundant locally, you know, but they're not pervasive. They're not large enough to where they're really out competing a lot of the native plants. But again, I don't know if anyone's actually really studied the impacts. But these are ones that kind of pop to mind as like I see them a lot when I'm in the field, but I never really think about them as suppressing the growth or choking out like the native plants, just because they're so small in stature. So there might be some other animal examples as well. I've been told actually an animal example. So in Southern California, we have these parrots that have been introduced. There was a movie about these parrots. They're also in San Francisco. I can't remember the name of the movie either. But there's an ornithologist at Chapman, and I'm like, we should study the effect that these invasive parrots are having on the native bird community. And he's just convinced that they're not inhabiting like an existing niche. They're actually using food sources that none of the native birds use, and so that they're actually, I mean, they're a pest because they're really loud, and they eat all your fruits and in your trees and stuff like that. But he doesn't think that they're displacing any native birds or anything like that. So I don't know. That might be an example from the animal world. Yeah.
Back to his previous question, in the rangeland health process, we separated them out as you did at the beginning. Presentation with non-native invasive. And to be an invasive, it has to have the capacity to dominate the site. Mm-hmm. Basically take over, change, and dominate the site. So that's erodium trichidarium, erodium motries, non-native, non-invasive.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, by the definition that I use, right, it'd be invasive because it does spread on its own. But through the definition that you use, it's not having a discernible impact. So yeah, okay, good. I'm glad I wasn't off the mark on that one. Yeah.
Well, I'll take you up on the biological control. Can you give? I mean, it seems like, and we can stick with plants. It seems like if a plant is truly invasive, able to come in and dominate. You're already at the last resort, and all you can do is fight it with biological control. Can you give some examples of where restoration alone is successful?
I guess not for eradication, right? So, I mean, some of the examples that I'll be talking about tomorrow in my research seminar, these are restoration techniques that you can use like in really small areas. Like, let's say you're working in a national park or like a sensitive ecological area and you can't introduce a biological control agent or you can't introduce like spray an herbicide or something like that. You know, these restoration protocols can work and they can eradicate things on small spatial scales. But oftentimes when you have, you know, like I'm thinking about the strawberry guava example in Hawaii, like they introduced that pest to control it just because there was no way, you know, that they could have controlled that otherwise. But even so, like I'm not really sure how many examples of biocontrol have been used to eradicate non-natives anyways. So...
Mm-hmm. Is restoration or removal going to be successful with that?
No, definitely not. We're never going to get rid of black mustard in Southern California, but we can figure out ways to manage it. In particular, you know, if we can keep the growth at bay. So I just learned actually a couple years ago that black mustard, you often see these sort of monospecific stands of it. It actually exudes an allele chemical that prevents any other plant from growing next to it. So that's a particularly bad example of that just because it's really hard to control because it has a lot of different weapons in its arsenal. But no, I think that a lot of these restoration protocols can be used just to manage systems, but when it comes to eradication, I don't know if they can do it for some of these more pervasive invaders. But again, I also don't know if biocontrol can do that either. So. Yeah.
So your example in New Zealand, you're talking about how hardcore they are.
Yeah.
And just made me think about how, in some cases with plants, since our society doesn't get too upset about the mass murder of plants, we've got more management options available to us. There's less sort of societal complications are fewer. And when you get into animals, maybe there needs to be some pretty delicate PR involved.
Yeah, it's a good point, but I disagree with you that plants or that people don't get passionate about invasive plants. Have you been following the eucalyptus debacle in the Bay Area? I think it's like in the Presidio or something that like all these people want to get rid of these invasive eucalypts, and like all these citizens of San Francisco banded together and like you absolutely can't get rid of these eucalypts. They're really important. And so I don't know. People get really passionate about plants too, but yeah, I definitely think that it's hard to eradicate animals, especially if they're really cute. People are going to be really upset about that. That's for sure. So. All right. Yes.
Just a question. As I have taken a bunch of plant classes, I'm always on the opposite end of the students that I go with. I'm kind of like, well, they're established now. This is their regime. This is what it is. When is that point where we just move forward, mm-hmm. accept that they're here, understand that there's going to be losses, and then try to work with the new current regime? Mm-hmm.
Is
that a point that's going to happen in our lifetime, or are we just going to keep trying to fight it for the 50 and then we'll accept?
Well, I think that it's going to happen on a species, like a case-by-case basis, right? So we've already made that call with like a lot of plant species that I'm aware of that where we just know we're never going to be able to get rid of them, but we have to figure out a way to manage them in the systems, especially the ones that are having big impacts. But we're still, I think everybody is still, like even the folks that publish those papers about like don't demonize non-native species. Like, I think even those people, like, if you could say, all right, we have this incipient population of this particularly nasty invasive plant, I think that they would be on board with, like, all right, well, let's get rid of it. You know, like, if it's going to be cheap and there's only, you know, like, this really small pocket of it, let's do that. Right, so I think that, you know, I don't think we're going to have like a blanket policy where all of a sudden one day we're going to be okay with like, all right, let's just let all the invasive species be and not manage them. I think we're going to need to deal with it on a case by case basis. Yeah.
I was just thinking of a case where you might, like, if you believe in global warming, right? Let's say you have an area where the temperature's changed, and so in order to have like prevent soil erosion, you want some type of plant growing there, and the old plant can't, it's used to the old environment, and now you got this invasive species, but it's really because of the global warming, and you really want it because the other one's not going to grow. Mm-hmm. You want to prevent soil erosion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. A related point is this idea of assisted migration, right? So the climate is changing so quickly, and we've now cut off a lot of these sort of natural migratory pathways for a bunch of plants and animals. People are thinking, like, should we actually assist their migration north, for example, so that they can track climate? And lots of people are saying, no, we shouldn't do that, right? Like, we're basically introducing species that are not, you know, in these regions now, and we should not do that. So this is another big debate going on in science right now. So yeah, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. I think it's another philosophical question. Yeah?
What's your favorite invader or story about?
Favorite invader? I don't know. That's really hard. I don't know if I've ever thought about that. It's so interesting. It's terrible to go hiking with me because I can't really appreciate invasive species for what they are. I really do like kahili ginger, that really beautiful plant that grows in Hawaii. It smells really, really nice. It's very beautiful. But even so, like, I would kill one in a heartbeat. So. I don't know. I should come up with a better story. I'll think of one. I'll think of a better story.
Great. Well, thank you very much, everybody.